So imagine you have a technology that can help you understand yourself, your cognitive load, all the things that are distracting you each hour during the day. This technology essentially enables you to have that type of information in real time.
There's a technology race happening that you may not have heard of, connecting our brains with our everyday tech.
Our dream is that you'll be able to walk into a store, pick up a pair of Beats headphones, Apple AirPods, a Bose headphone, put them on your head, they can record your brain activity, and you can seamlessly switch your music, send a text message, etc., etc.
But connecting our brains to our technology raises a lot of questions.
The world is already moving toward a place where this technology is going to become essential. It's becoming inevitable that this future that we're creating is going to happen.
Should we be concerned when neurotech companies want access to our brains? And are we ready for a mind control sci-fi future?
I thought to myself, the only way to really reach that goal that I want to accomplish, to create a world without limitations, is to be the one to push it as well too.
This is a show about founders challenging the status quo. Ramses is demoing their brain-computer interface tech.
What I'm doing is I'm focusing. And now we're gonna see the effects of my focus if we introduce a distractor of something really cute like my dog. Neurable is focused on creating what we call an everyday brain-computer interface. How do you make technology that just seamlessly integrates into everything around you?
This idea is not a new one. Scientists have been advancing this kind of tech since the 70s. You've seen it as EEG in hospitals for diagnosing brain conditions, generally with a skull cap and a bunch of sensors, or maybe as an implant, or partnered with a prosthetic. Ramses and his team have taken the tech out of the lab and into consumer markets.
The first part of our journey has been, how do we take this lab-grade technology and make it fit into an everyday device? And so what we did as an innovation is we identified that there was a specific type of brain signal that we were looking for, and we developed a modeling approach to only focus on identifying that core specific signal. And that was such a huge step that we thought, wow, we have something special here. Now it's time to really bring this out to the world. The next big milestone was getting this technology down to something that fits around your ear.
Wearing headphones feels normal. We wouldn't have to learn new behaviors to adopt neurotechnology into our lives. Think of it like a Fitbit for your brain.
Really, the secret sauce is our software. It is able to interpret brain data better than anything else in the market.
It gives you an insight on how your environment is affecting your brain. So things like productivity, focus, flow, but also burnout. All while reading your thoughts?
Our technology is not reading your thoughts. It's just reading large-scale changes in electrical activation. For example, if you start reading a book or doing coding or anything that really activates your brain, your frontal lobe starts to increase in electrical activity because it's processing information. And so we're able to understand that there's an increase of focus and processing that's occurring. And that's what we're really picking up. Part of making sure that this is an everyday device is we wanted to make sure that it could work passively, that you don't have to do anything special to make it work. You can just put them on and it's recording your activity, and whenever you want to volitionally do something, they're able to pick it up and understand you. I believe entrepreneurship really means that there's something that you feel inside you that doesn't sit well. You look at the world and you see somebody's pain and you think, why should this exist? This should be done better. You know, if no one else is gonna do it, then damn it, you're gonna do it yourself. We had patented the technology and we brought it to the tech transfer office and we said, hey, so what's next? Are we gonna change the world with this? Like, this is incredible. And they said, well, you know, we're gonna license it out. We're gonna go talk to these groups. And at that point I said, that seems really slow. Like, I can't see it really moving forward. And so they kind of jokingly said, well, you can make a startup. This was the next stage in that chapter toward developing that mission. When I was about 8 years old, my uncle got into a trucking accident. He lost both his legs, and it was one of the most traumatic moments for me personally. But what it really instilled is this deep passion toward how do we create technology that can help everyone participate equally. At that point, I felt that the right step was to understand how circuits worked, how control systems worked for prosthetic devices. So I went to the University of Washington, studied electrical engineering there. And what I noticed is there was this huge disconnect between the actual brain and the machines that we were controlling. And so that's when I decided to get my PhD in neuroscience. And then from there, the opportunity to build something and to accelerate this future was entrepreneurship.
Hey everyone, how's it going?
Good, how are you?
Good, good.
Second track, which is a different one.
The biggest challenge that we have in front of us is making sure that the technology works seamlessly across multiple individuals, which is a very difficult thing to do because everyone's brain is different. In order to make it so that this technology can work across multiple people, we need to collect a lot more data. But it is also your brain, and there is a emotional connection to that as users.
Whoa. A lot more data?
Help me understand, if you sell your technology to like Apple, they put it in their AirPods, how do you keep Apple from not collecting your data?
Okay. All right, I guess we're gonna go on record on this one, okay. So right now when we're working with partners that are gonna be integrating our technology into their products, we're very strict with them about respecting that user privacy and that data. We want to make sure that a user has full agency behind it, instead of just hiding everything into an end user licensing agreement and taking everything that they have, because that erodes trust. The companies that work in neurotech have to learn from the mistakes of the past, specifically the internet.
With the internet, we've saved little bits of data that have created shortcuts in our lives. Things like cookies and auto checkout, but we are still incorporating all the ways to protect that data.
We have an opportunity to do better now that we've seen these mistakes occur as we move forward toward this high data future. Coming from academia, that is actually one of the core reasons why ethics is so important to us. We've all gone through IRB training. We all understand HIPAA regulations. We all understand what anonymous data versus, you know, identifiable data is. From our perspective, we like to think of it as an individual. That gives us an advantage in really establishing the types of ethics we want to follow at the company. When you're looking at the future, you have to have a very concrete pathway of how you're going to get this technology into millions of people's hands. I've been asked numerous times, why devote your entire life to one thing? My response to that is that it's not done yet. I know that this is the world that I want to see, that I want to create, and that I want everyone to experience. And so my mission's not done until that's done.
Killer. He is an emotional support animal.
Yeah. That's right.
I mean, I support his emotions more likely.